Hello, I am Chauncey Devega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, SiriusXM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as The Chauncey Devega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey Devega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable, you know.
He goes by the name of Chauncey Devega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey Devega.
As my man Chauncey Devega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey Devega here with us.
Hello! That's my fundraising hello for the second week of the fundraiser here on the eponymously named podcast known as The Chauncey Devega Show. The Chauncey Devega Show. See, I'm doing a little singing because I'm not as cold as I was last week, people. Got a great guest for this, the second week of the fundraiser. This, the second podcast of the second week in the 12th month. Wow, I did like a World War I thing there, didn't I? Let's do it again. This is the second week of the 12th month and the second week of the fundraiser. See, I done messed it up when I went back to it. Sometimes you just got to let magic happen. So, you know, we got to get all the tedium out of the way. Got a great, great conversation. I'm telling you, every episode this fundraising month is especially good. Especially good. I stammered there, and I'll tell you why. Because I turned off my speech affect denying switch yesterday and today. I'm going to have to reinstate it. Reboot it. It was part of a strategy. So Ned and Constance Sublette, author of the great book, The American Slave Coast, they are the guests on this week's episode of the podcast, known as the Chauncey Devega Show. You know, they got that old expression. You ever hear this from like the 60s or 70s in a blaxploitation movie? Or just from your older uncle who thinks he's still cool and he's like damn near 70 years old and he's wearing FUBU jeans and a FUBU sweater. And he comes to the cookouts and he's wearing like new Nikes. And he's just trying to stay, as he would say, I'm still hip with it. And my uncle, he would say, I'll go lay something heavy on you, Chauncey. Well, that's what this great conversation is with the Sublettes. They laying something heavy on us, folks, about America's internal slave trade, the transatlantic slave trade, the many, 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 many millions lost, the capitalized womb, the true depths and expansiveness of white supremacy in the West across the Black Atlantic. I'm telling you, you're going to hear some moments in this conversation, folks. You're going to hear one where I almost sort of break up. You can hear in my voice, I'm just like, damn. Another moment where I'm just like, oh, my God. And that's the power of these two wonderful historians and storytellers. There's a moment with some singing of the blues. There's storytelling about a horrible place in Texas where the bodies are thrown in the swamps. And Ned and Constance, man, they just lay it on me. They lay it on us. So business, I'm sitting upright. I got a problem, people. I got a problem. In addition to my soda addiction, I had food poisoning and I was on the street going, throwing up my guts. I have had cravings. I've never been one to be food centered or to have cravings. I'm thinking the parasites in my GI tract got all vomited out. Maybe I need to eat some yogurt or something. Because Chauncey Devega just ain't right. Last week it was the cold, and apparently it's going to be 60 degrees here in Chicago tomorrow, so I will be enjoying that weather, even if it is raining. But I've been having cravings. I think as I have turned 40 that my system is run amok. It's out of sorts. I'm looking at you now. You know about my soda problem, and I got it. I got the soda. You hear it. And we're going to have a can opening together, people. I have discovered, I see the marketing on this because I'm simple-minded. And bright packages appeal to me like a bee or an insect or a bird. Starburst has a new flavor, super fruit flavors, people. Listen to this lineup. It almost fools me into thinking I'm eating something healthy. Raspberry pomegranate, strawberry starfruit, passion fruit punch, and blueberry acai. A-C-A-I, I think that's how you pronounce it. I'm getting cravings. As I said, I think the parasites in my systems is all met. And I'm going to do a little oversharing. I'm going to get to the soda people. I'm telling you, we got the great episode. I have been on a roll. I have been talking to some amazing people this month. You get everybody you can during December, January, because they're home. And I got some other folk I'm still waiting on. But the conversation I had last night, another preview, folks, of what's coming down the road. author of a great new book on the life and times of Gary Gygax, who invented Dungeons and Dragons. And I learned some stuff. They need to make a movie about this man's life, by the way. One of my favorite conversations. Brother's here in Chicago, so he and I are going to have to hook up again, get a beer or two or three. But he's coming down around the bend. You see, I tease things. But let me settle down. Let me settle down and tell you about this addiction I got. As I said, we got great episode, American Slave Coast. We're going to talk about, I was on the RT. I was also on a new show. I have not been on. It's not a new show. I've been around a long time. Dave Packman Show. That's tonight, Wednesday, as I'm doing the intros and outros, a promo for this great episode of the podcast known as the Chauncey Devega Show. But I've been getting these hungers. And I don't think I'm diabetic. This can be traced back to two events, people. You and I are friends. We have been around the bend. There are some things coming down. As I said, it's going to be glorious or it will end in disaster. But I'm going to go out fighting. I'm going to be on Fury Road like Mad Max. You remember that scene? I love it. Valhalla. Witness me. See, I got the sugar in me. Because last week I had to have the sugar to get the melanin to vibrate. But we're going to talk about my recent appearances on the TV thing online and the regular TV, which is always cool. And yes, people, I don't have jaundice. I investigated this. Why I look like a pumpkin. I'm a man. I'm not a pumpkin. And I discovered that there's a thing that goes on where they send that signal up to the outer space. And it comes down. And because they have to master it to go on the YouTube machine, it makes you look orange. I don't have jaundice. I knew it. But I think I look better yesterday and today. I did, as I said, this is Wednesday. Did that conversation on Ring of Fire, rather, host of Ring of Fire, Mike Papantoni, was sitting in for Tom Hartman on the Big Picture on the RT. That was yesterday. Some of you saw that. I put it up on ChaunceyVega.com. Other folks sent me emails and on Twitter saying, oh, we saw you. That was sort of cool. So I did something a little different in those two appearances. So as I said, I'm sharing a little bit. Two events. One was my near breaking of the leg on Mad Max night. That was a psychic and physical trauma. I think it disrupted my chi energy. And I think it got out of alignment. I think some of my chakras was busted up. Because since then, I haven't been able to exercise, right? Because I couldn't walk for weeks and months. And my knee's still messed up. And when it's cold out, it swells. I know I got to just go to the doctor, but I don't want to. I don't want to go to the doctor. Because he's going to tell me if I tore up all sorts of stuff. Maybe my leg's broken. Okay. Settling down. That was a trauma. And you see, when the body suffers a trauma, it compensates. So I've been having these cravings. And then I got the food poisoning. And I'm a man of iron will, steel constitution. Joe Stalin would look at me and say, Chauncey, you are a man, not a man spider, a man. And I only get sick on average once a year. And that is because of the following regimen, people. So come closer. I'm going to tell you how to stay healthy. Ginger and ginseng every day. Mega Men prostate potency sex pills. Take that vitamin twice a day. You take two of them each day. And I got a pill cutter because they're like horse pills. And I got to cut it up so I don't choke. I take, when I go to bed, sleep with the windows open and a fan on no matter how cold it is. The colder it is, the better, because you're getting the germs out. You're circulating the air. And you see demons that get in your system. They like stale air. Anybody ever have a friend growing up? I knew a few folks. I don't know if any white folks are down with this. Maybe it's a Southern thing. Maybe it's just a Midwest. Maybe it's a cheap thing. Maybe it's these are smart people who were the millionaire next door save money. Did you have any friends in the winter who put plastic up all over all the windows and the house always smelled like fried food? Because they fried all the damn time. And I love these people. Like, they family. But they never had the air. Amazingly clean people. They weren't funny. It was immaculate people. Immaculate house. But they was sick on occasion because the air was not circulating. That's the other secret. You got to have circulating air. Now, your bathroom. I'm giving you the secrets that Methuselah used to stay healthy. Now, in your bathroom, if you don't have a window in the bathroom, and even if you do, you need to make sure that you're cleaning the walls and the ceiling of the bathroom regularly. Because if you look up there, you'll notice mold. It could be black mold, which will kill you, or yellow mold, which is just aerosolized poop and pee. Now, these are the things you got. And every night, have a beer or two or some whiskey. These things will keep you youthful and vigorous and young and powerful. But see, I haven't been exercising right, folks. See, I'm getting in my storytelling mode before I open up this soda and chase it with a starburst, people. I can't promise what I'm going to do after that. The melanin may combust. You may have fission. Fission may take place here in this overpriced Chicago apartment. So, just not myself. Appetites, eating things I shouldn't be eating. And I looked at myself on the TV thing, and I said I got fat. I don't know how celebrities, Hollywood people who age on the silver screen, see themselves 40 feet high, or bigger than that on an IMAX screen, how they deal with it. I was like, Chauncey, you look fat. And I know my pants, they feel the same, but I noticed something, people. And as I said, if there are children nearby, or you just don't want the visual cover yours. So I'm in the shower because I don't believe in baths. Baths are disgusting. You sit in your own filth. It's dirty and it's dead skin. And I don't know why anybody finds anything romantic to do in the shower. If you have sex in the shower, all it means is one party is getting cold and not warm. And that's not sexy to me. If I'm gonna take you on Space Mountain, baby, we got to shower separately. That's just a hint for anybody lining up for Space Mountain. So I was in the shower doing my routine. You know what a gentleman does. I'm going to use a dirty word. I don't routinely swear, but the order should always be shit, shower, shave. Now, that's my morning routine. I'm just divulging. I'm sharing. Because you all folks with family, and some of you have been so generous with the fundraising, I'm going to give you an update on that. I feel like I got to share. I'm in the shower doing my things, washing, bathing, getting all the crevices clean, because you never know when Halle Berry or Rosario Dawson will see your brother walking down Michigan Avenue and say, Chauncey, and Halle Berry being that monster's ball mode, or Rosario, she'll be, oh Lord, Rosario. She'll be like that movie Kids, or some of them other movies. I like that new movie, Top Five. Ooh, she's sexy. And I'm standing there, and something didn't feel right. Not that. But it is sort of that. I said, I feel like I'm fat. Do I have elephantiasis of the dingus? Or the testes? Because something feels wrong down. Guess what it was? Here's how I know I've gained weight. The tops of my thighs are starting to come together a little bit. This is unacceptable. So Chauncey Devega, see, I may have to break up with the soda people. I know I can't, but I'm going to try because something ain't right. Or I must have to, because it's cold, because I used to walk 2 to 3 miles a day. And like I said, we do these promos. I just go where we may. This great episode of the podcast about the American Slave Coast. You get everything here. Buffet and appetizer. I'm giving you the high-end buffet, even though you know my thoughts on buffets. I told you I went to one on Thanksgiving. So it's not elephantiasis of the dingus. You ever seen them pictures when you were a kid, National Geographic, with the man with his testes and organ in a wheelbarrow, that African man? Poor man, or Indian man, he got bit by a titsy fly or TC fly and made his stuff swell up. But I'm getting fat, and it's not my dingus. Isn't that fascinating how the human body, the dingus, never gains weight? Ain't that something? And I actually have a really cool guest coming up next year. Talked to him a few months ago. Made a cool documentary called Dickumentary. Yes, it's a documentary about the cultural history of the penis. Cool, cool, cool conversation. So I was on, as I said, Ring of Fire and a new show tonight, Wednesday, for me, Dave Pakman. And we talked about Trump, we talked about fascism, and I tried to do something a little different. And you can tell me if it worked. One of the criticisms I get from folks is that some people really like to, like, man, you look so polished. You never say, you never look like you're thinking about anything. You just hit the mark. And somebody told me that actually makes you seem less real because everybody thinks. Everybody, for the most part, says, or they have a tick. So I said, yesterday and today, I'm going to be a little more personable. In that way, I'm going to let the speech affect, because I think I'm pretty lucky and blessed in that regard. When I feel something coming out in terms of a speech affect, I stop it. That I'm a quick thinker, man. Just like the wolf in Pulp Fiction, think quick and talk fast, whatever that gentleman said. So I let two things, I said and I think I said or something. And then today on the Pakman show, you can see me pausing and collect my thoughts, and I have a momentary stammer. And that was on purpose, people. I was trying to drop the mask a little bit. So you tell me if that helps or hinders my performance on the TV machine. But I think I had two good interviews. And as I pointed out there, and of course, great episode again. I'm going to get to it, folks. I know we go a little long sometimes because we're sharing stories. We're sharing stories about Donald Trump and fascism. I'm going to point something out. And I said it during those conversations, and I'm going to repeat it every time I get a chance to talk about Donald Trump, the Donald Trump phenomenon, carnival show, proto-fascist, professional wrestling manager heel wannabe that he is. You got to pay attention to the bigger game, you see. You got to pay attention. Don't focus on the superficial BS that you're getting from the mainstream media. Everybody's throwing all these articles being written. Is Donald Trump a fascist? He's a fascist, yes. No, he's not a fascist. Maybe he's a fascist in this way. And all that stuff is valuable because you got to define terms, you see. But the reality of what you want to do is, who cares if he's a fascist? No, hear me out. Don't worry about the word. See, they got you looking at the left hand when the magic is going on in the right hand. What? Here's what you ask yourself. Marcus Aurelius, a person adopts the attributes and qualities of their behavior. What are his policies? What are his actions? What does he want to do? That's all you care about, people. He can be a pickleist. He can be a hemorrhoidist. He can be a hero or gyroist. That's a huge debate about how you pronounce that sandwich. I don't care what the hell you call this man. Conservatism and racism are now the same thing in the Republican Party and have been since at least the Civil Rights Movement. We are in a moment, as Brother Henry Giroux has deftly outlined, Sheldon Wolin and others, of soft authoritarianism. We also have a lot of empirical data on this. You have a Republican Party, and I said this in the two interviews, where they are chasing Trump. That means he's their id. He has exposed the hustle. He is showing these white, right-wing, low-information voters. And I said low-information. That's an empirical question. We can go actually look that up and they do some polling on these folks. I don't think they're poor white people. I think we get poor white people too much crap in this country. They're demobilized. They tend to vote for Democrats. They're not Republicans. The folks who are supporting him are angry older white folks, new middle class, and first-generation working class types. Those folks who voted against their own insurance in Kentucky, they're voting for Donald Trump, you see. And the other ones have created this monster. Christie is a racist based on his actions and statements. Cruz, most certainly. Trump, we know. Rubio, of course. Ben Carson is a self-hating black racial opportunist. The Republican Party is the country's largest white identity organization. Once you understand that, you understand Donald Trump's particular brand of right-wing producerism and proto-fascism, but don't fall for the hustle, people. Don't let them distract you with, is he a fascist? Who cares? Call him whatever the hell you want to call him. Look at his policies about breaking the Constitution to harass Muslim people, closing down centers of religious worship simply because of the folks who are there, never mind monitoring these damn churches, which are far more dangerous than mosques in this country. Talking about databases for people, you might as well give Muslims a crescent to wear the way this man is going. Why did they do that? I don't need the flavor saver for that, folks. You know exactly what the illusion is. Jews and gays and lesbians with the rainbow and the star. We know when that happened, that horrid situation in Germany. But watch these people. Watch them. Don't fall for the long con. And speaking of interesting things, I'm going to do a little pop culture wrap-up later because the conversation is some real teaching, heavy hitting, body blows. Blows to the head, blows to the heart. I mean, awesome stuff. I saw that movie Spotlight about them predatory, perverted priests in Boston and all over the world. Check that movie out. That's Oscar money there. It's going to get nominated. It's going to get nominated. Will it win? I don't know. I don't know. But I have told this story to folks before. You know, this is why, as I said, you know my opinions about religion, how religion damages the mind. Here's a thought experiment for you people. Let's say that mosques all over this country had men molesting boys. Do you think that those imams would have been able to avoid prosecution? Do you think that the Muslim church, or the equivalent, right, because a decentralized faith, whatever the national organization would be, would have avoided being locked up and its leaders put in jail for criminal conspiracy because they covered it up? But somehow the Catholic Church avoided that. And I was sitting here watching that movie saying, if these people were Muslim, Lord of mercy, the hell that would have come down. And you're watching this movie. As I said, I'm an agnostic atheist. We have a great guest who's the president of the American Atheist Association. He'll be on in a few. And we break down the difference between secular humanism, atheism, agnosticism. And I'm watching that movie saying, these people say, how can some of these Muslims support terrorism? How can they be part of a faith that wants to blow people up? Number one, they're misspecifying their argument. Number two, you're talking about a small number of people out of billions of them. But they say it. But they don't look in the mirror and say, my God, how can I be part of a church, Catholic church, of people being molested and they're covering up kids and young people's lives ruined, boys and girls being molested by these predator, sick, freak priests and brothers and other people. But imagine the counterfactual if they were Muslim, the hell that would have come down. And as I said, I've told people this story. I was about 12 or 13. True story, folk, real, keeping it 100. And I've told the story before. And my father dragging me to a black Catholic church, one of a few. This is during the era when you had that St. Martin de Porres, that video. Like a dream, oh boy. Is it like a prayer? Like a prayer. And my father, this is how these perverted priests get boys. This comes up in the movie now. That's why you got to check it out. They single out boys they think are vulnerable because the parents love, oh, they want the attention. Oh, the church. They're like, oh, the priest is paying attention to my son. It's such a wonderful thing. Oh, this is a great position. He's an altar boy. I had none of that. But my father nagged me and nagged me and nagged me to go meet with this African priest. Let me tell you what went down, folks. Go to meet the gentleman. And I'm young, 11, 12. I like talking to adults about interesting things. I was going to challenge him about theodicy, good and evil, and biblical interpretation to the degree an 11 or 12-year-old could who's been doing a little reading, because I already had serious doubts about this. In my heart, I had denounced religion, but I hadn't come out and said it. I hadn't gone on my strike yet where I refused to go to church. This man looked at me. I'm telling you that this is an adult. Even then, I knew something was wrong because I was messing with the girls even at that age. Remember that summer? You go back between 5th and 6th grade, and instead of pulling a girl's hair, you want to do something else? Exactly. So I knew I liked me some poontang, even though I couldn't articulate. Well, that's not true, because my friends and I were talking about having sex with girls we actually hadn't had sex with. But again, you were all there, too. Ghetto nerd storytelling for another time. So this priest, he had lust in his eyes. I'm telling you, even at that age, I sensed something was wrong. And as an adult looking back, that man had lust in his eyes. So we talk for a half hour, 45 minutes, and he keeps trying to reach across, get closer and closer to me. And I'm like, what the hell's going on here? What's going on, dude? You need to get away from me. That's my southern hillbilly accent. So at the end of the meeting, he's like, I would like to continue to see you. I'm doing my fake African voice, but please indulge me. It's just role playing. I think you have a lot of potential. Oh, you're so intelligent. I want to take a special interest in you. Oh, you're very, very special, like your father said. And then he goes, and I went to shake his hand. I was nervous, like, I'm getting out of here. He takes my hand and holds it, takes off his gold watch, an actual gold watch, gives it to me, and starts stroking the other side of my hand with his hand. I kid you not. I said, thank you, sir. I don't need the watch. But he was like, no, please. Please, it is a gift from me to you. It will bind us together. Oh, I cannot wait to see you again. I was like, okay, I got shit. I got the hell out of there. I told my mother, I thought she was going to beat the man up. And she's like, no, it's your imagination. My father didn't want to hear. I was like, no, that man is trying to get his freak on. So go see Spotlight. That was not a part of my plan for this evening to tell that story. But hold on. That's even before the soda. Hold on. Okay. I started resisting. Here it is. Whew. Hold on. Tonight's soda love partner that's causing me elephantiasis. Not of the dingus or testes, but of the upper thigh to gain weight. And I need to go to the exercise room and ride a bike every day because I can't walk 3 miles a day. You know her name. You know her babe. You know when we've got a great conversation, I go to the favorite. I go to the bottom soda. You know what I mean by that if you watch American Pimp. Shasta. The Cadillac of sodas. Root beer, caffeine free. Carbonated water, high fructose corn. Oh, that's it. That's what I need. High fructose corn syrup, caramel color, natural and artificial flavors, potassium benzoate, which is a preservative, and something called sucralose. Oh, God. Oh, yes, yeah, sucralose. Hold on, sucralose. Here it comes, everybody. You know this is our ritual here on the Chauncey Devega Show. Woo-hoo! That's the glass. Here it comes. It's going to hit my lips soon. Hold on. One more hit. Hold on. I'm trying to calm down. Hold on. I'm going to follow it with a chaser, guys. Following with a chaser. Hold on. My hands are shaking. I know you're concerned about my health. I know you are. But I'm a man with problems. I got demons, people. You got demons, too. Don't pretend you don't. This is a Fruit Punch Chew Starburst from the Super Fruit Pack. Let me put it in my mouth and see if I can talk water in there. It's nice. Very nice. Hear me chewing. Hold on. All right. So back to business, people, because that's how we have fun here on the almost 100th episode of the podcast known as the Chauncey Devega Show. You just I don't know what I'm going to do. I just know we bring some great teaching and sharing smart people doing interesting and smart things on the podcast. So fundraiser, of course, I want to thank everybody who donated. Wonderful, wonderful generosity. The first week I was nervous. And then, of course, like timing immortal. Maybe you guys are elder gods or old ones. Folks sense through the force. You need to throw some gold and silver into that begging bowl. And folks did that. I have set an amount. You know, I'm going to use it to start a video podcast. That's part of the new project. I can't give details. I'm still in the process of having conversations with people. But trust me, I think it'll be cool. Get the video podcast set up. As I said, I'm 100% with folk. Get that ticket, hopefully, to go home see Mama DeVega, surprise her at Christmas, because some tickets cost an arm and a leg. And get myself a bottle of cologne and go to a nice meal to recharge. Because, you know, the podcast, the writing online, salon, elsewhere. I had the hot hand at salon. Folks may have noticed this last few weeks. This week, some stuff's going to show up. I got some stuff. I fired a broadside from the battleship Indomitable. And last week, I told you about the journey about changing the name. So, again, with hands open for friends and fans of the podcast, I mean, that money's going to go to good use. I'm going to do a logo because you have to have a backdrop. I'm going to get a green screen set up. I went to the photo store where all the fancy professional photographer types go, and I asked about a proper lighting setup, and they were very helpful. So that should come in pretty cheap. I already have two of the lights. I need another thing. It'd be like $150 for that. The camera, the green screen, the stands. Got the mics. We got all the stuff we need. And that's where your kind generosity will go to. So second week of the fundraiser, I was a little nervous. I was like, uh-oh, crickets. Lo and behold, the cavalry showed up again. And I want to thank some folks who were so super generous. I will be sending out my thank you notes. You know that. As I said, I like to be vague about what the goal is, but we're about 60% there. So if folks in the next few days and next week, we can get this taken care of, and folks want to keep me in mind for Christmas, that will be awesome. But I got to keep gently nodding, gently nudging and prodding. Right. That's how the video podcast is going to get done. You know, I take about 10 to 20, sometimes more hours a week with the writing, interviews, the podcast. I mean, a lot of hours. I got to tell you, this week I was like, man, it's like a job. I love it, but it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work to talk to all these great people. I've had the blessed opportunity to sit down and share with all of you guys. So if you like, support, value what we're doing here on the podcast, chauncedevega.com, aka Indomitable, classic. Classic name. We are respectable Negroes. We are respectable Negroes. WARN. Please try to throw some love in there, you know? PayPal link on the right-hand sidebar of chauncedevega.com. Gold, silver, platinum, if you got it. Paper. That's cool, too. And positive energy. And as I say, take care of yourself. I know the economy is still broken despite these gimmicked unemployment numbers. The numbers look stable because people stop looking for work, by the way, people. And the jobs people are getting pay less than the ones they had before this great recession / depression, because economists in the future, historians will say this was a depression, by the way. Take care of your pets, your parents, your kids, yourself. If you got some change left over, you value what we're doing here. Hey, if you like the last 10 episodes, put a dollar an episode in. If you like the last 50, put a quarter an episode in. Please, it means a lot. But without further ado, as I said, this is some heavy stuff, folks. This is real talk. These are an amazing conversation. So, as I'm holding the book in my hand, because it's a tome, and I mean that, 700 pages, a dynamite of amazing teaching, of amazing scholarship, and I want to thank Ned and Constance Sublette for writing this great book, American Slave Coast, A History of the Slave Breeding Industry. And, you know, I don't often do this, but I'm going to do it because this is a really rare book in the sense a publisher's allowed a book this long and this thorough to be written. That comes up in the conversation. So Lawrence Hill Books, thanking them for putting this out. And I'm open. You hear me opening up the book because I want to get the imprint right. Lawrence Hill Books out of Chicago, Chicago Review Press Incorporated. So definitely keep them in your gift-giving list. Because trust me, after you hear this conversation, if you have not read this book, you're going to want to go out and buy it. And you're going to want to gift it to people. And as I told these great guests, and it's always hard when you're talking to two people at once. And again, dropping the mask about how cool this was, we had technical difficulties, and we couldn't do the conference thing on Skype. So then I said, hey, adapt, achieve, overcome. I think the Army and the Marines have a version of that slogan. Get a landline and pass it back and forth and we'll edit it together. And let me tell you, I was like, oh my God, this is not going to work out. We're off rhythm. We're starting late. They were awesome, kind, and generous. And just as a natural rhythm. So you'll hear that back and forth. I think there's one moment where I actually leave it in where I think Ned asks Constance, he says, you know, can I have the telephone? Or she gives him back the telephone. And these are just wonderful people. Wonderful people. And they are, this work is a treasure. You're going to learn a lot about our country, about the hidden history, the real history of this country, and slavery and white supremacy. The basis of American empire was slave breeding, and we'll get into the details, and the financialized, commodified womb of black women. That, man, it's tough. This is a heavy one. But listen to it. I'm sure you're going to enjoy it. I'm sure you're going to learn a lot from it. And as I say, I always like to thank all of you for listening, downloading, sharing, and tweeting the podcast. And if you've never shared the show before, or if you have not told folks about what we're trying to do here, over now 3 years of the podcast, 8 years of the website, I think this episode could be a really good entry point for sharing. I really think share this episode with folks and tell them, yeah, there's a crazy black man named Chauncey Devega who's addicted to soda, who talks about his dingus in the shower and fascism and pickles and what we should really be paying attention to. But at about the, looking at the time code here, 30 or so minute mark after that extended promo, he gets to the guests, Ned and Constance Sublette, American Slave Coast. I think this will be a show you will want to share. I think they're all good, but this is one I think it's like a TV series. You know, fourth season, it's a new place for people to jump on. So I want to thank Ned and Constance one more time for being so generous with their teaching and for sitting down and writing this wonderful and important book. Next segment, Ned and Constance Sublette, here on the eponymously named podcast known as The Chauncey Devega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
So, you know, how did the American Slave Coast, as I said, obviously starting with an honest compliment, not trying to blow smoke up anybody's behind or shine them up, but I remember from Connecticut going down to New York as a child. My parents allowed me a lot of freedom. I would get on the train when I was 10 and go to New York or 11. You know, we had payphones and I had money. My parents would go to jail for doing that now, the way the laws are.
That's right.
So I remember going 11, 12, 13, you know, when New York was still New York, and you'd go to Harlem, and right near the Apollo, I'm sure you've been there many times, you'd have all the booksellers. And they'd have all the books laid out. And you'd have these great presses from works from independent scholars. You'd have Third World Press. And I'm sitting there saying, my God, all this amazing information. Number one, the things I was hungry for, learning about the real American history, that wasn't being taught. And I went to a good public school. Wasn't being taught in the public school. And I'm talking to these interesting people. And I'm reading about, you know, all these books about slavery, about the Middle Passage. And I'm buying all these books. And they're like, who's this crazy 11 or 12-year-old buying all these books? But the folks were eager to teach. And I remember discovering a book, and the title escapes me. Probably have it at home at my parents' house. About the idea of sort of, you know, slave breeding and the economics. It wasn't Eric Williams' Capitalism and Slavery, of course. I saw that later on. But just about sort of the biopolitics of slavery. And I was so impressed by your, you and your wife's rigorous scholarship, because the economics around the biopolitics of slavery for so long has been like this taboo topic.
Yeah.
And you didn't see a lot of mainstream folks picking it up, but other folks were talking about it for a long time. So I get your book and it's a revelation. So I want to thank you for that.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. I mean, the guy who really blew the subject wide open was Frederick Bancroft. Frederick Bancroft was back in the days when you had to have an independent fortune to be a historian. Bancroft did he's the one for whom the Bancroft Prize at Columbia is named. In the early 20th century, like the first decade of the 20th century already, was in the Deep South interviewing formerly enslaved people and former slave traders about the domestic slave trade. And he was the one who first blew the whistle on, he called it the slave raising. Slave rearing. There was a chapter in his book, his 1931 classic, Slave Trading in the Old South, which he published privately as a response to U.B. Phillips's racist history of slavery, which has been forgotten by mainstream historians largely, but it's still there. Historians of this subject know about it, but it's been left out of the mainstream historical narrative. But it's there. His papers are at Columbia, and Constance and I went to Columbia and spent quite some time going through them. I'm going to pass the phone to Constance now, mm-hmm. so she can tell you a little more about that.
Hi. That was quite an experience, going through these boxes, some of which the materials have been missing, as over the years, and he got rediscovered, people have been sort of filtering them. But we mm-hmm. found a whole manuscript that he had never published, which was about his experiences in the South and many other things. And everywhere he had recorded his interviews by hand first, and then he paid a woman to type up the interviews. And everywhere he went, whenever he met someone who had been formerly enslaved, he asked how they had come to where they were now. And he has all these graphs, statistical pileups that show that most of them had come from elsewhere, i.e. it had been through the slave breeding industry, they had been sold down south. And he also breaks it down too, of course, by the numbers of people who had been brought by their owners when they transplanted themselves to more fertile territory that had opened. But the vast majority of them had been sold, and most of them had been sold out of the Chesapeake region.
And that's a very important point. So again, sort of, I was telling your husband, thinking about, you know, you have sort of the mainstream historical scholarship on slavery, you have the popular understanding, which we'll talk about chattel slavery, which is, again, so inaccurate and so distorted. And then you have that puzzle about the number of slaves that were actually brought to the United, what would become the United States, was relatively small compared to other parts of the Caribbean or certainly Brazil. But then you have, as you know, your book so deftly points out, I mean, it's rich scholarship. As I said, it's a wonderfully cited, the historiography is so impressive. Thinking about, okay, you have a system of quote-unquote slave breeding, which certainly involves sexual coercion. Also, the internal trade within the United States, which again, the general public doesn't really understand. The different varieties of slavery regionally, right? So be a slave, human property in Florida or Texas at a mine or working at a rice plantation or sugarcane in the Caribbean is very different from being a slave who was owned, who worked as a blacksmith.
That's right.
In the Carolinas or in Washington, outside of D.C. or even Boston. And then you have that big puzzle about why did the slave population in the United States, why was it self-sustaining and why did it grow? So, I mean, you're doing some wonderful work.
Well, there have been so many wonderful scholars who have been doing the work all along. The last 20 years or so, it's just had one spectacular work after another published, and we're really grateful to all the work that they did. But how it came about, we had a very special situation here mm-hmm. in what became the United States that didn't exist anywhere else, and it only existed, in fact, in that Chesapeake region that allowed the 300,000 plus Africans who had been actually imported to this part of the world become almost 4 million.
Yeah, I jump in when I hear numbers. Yeah, what Constance was saying is that only in Virginia and Maryland did the conditions exist for a slave breeding industry to happen, because elsewhere in the hemisphere, most of those 10.7 million who arrived alive were brought to do sugar. But in the Chesapeake, under the relatively lighter, though still toxic, work of raising tobacco, milder climate, better food, closer to gender parity, fewer horrible diseases, the enslaved numbers increased. This was already going on in the 17th century, a unique phenomenon in the hemisphere, which meant that Virginia, by the time of independence, had been slave breeding for more than a century, the owners watching their slave holdings grow as the tobacco lands played out from over farming. So by the time of independence, the most profitable thing for Virginia slaveholders to do with their growing labor force was to sell them to people setting up in the newer territories who needed to do the harder work of clearing the land and establishing new plantations. This became a conversion cycle as Kentucky filled up with farm. It stopped being a net importer from Virginia and Maryland and became a net exporter of people to newly opened territories, et cetera. And this worked its way down, providing, in fact, a tremendous population pressure and an economic motive, because ultimately it was a Ponzi scheme, to expand the slavery nation into more and more new territories, sort of climaxing in the annexation of Texas.
Not to fixate on the morbid, but when I've taught classes on race and when we talk about slavery, transatlantic slave trade, I'm sure it's a question you've heard many times, but I understand it, you know, as an African-American sort of searching for our own history, trying to have a true reckoning and account of the Black Atlantic and chattel slavery and its human cost, which is why I love Marcus Rediker's book on the slave ship. What is the consensus now about the actual numbers? So we have Curtin's numbers about the transatlantic slave trade. We have some new scholarship. I think the Global Voyages Project, that you can actually go online and search shipping manifests. Mm-hmm. What is the actual number the scholars agree on about the number of Africans brought to the quote-unquote New World, across the Black Atlantic, who actually, number one, we know how many survived, but how many folks actually died? What's the consensus at this point? Do we even know?
The numbers that we go with, the numbers we use, because they seem to be the best research numbers out there, they may be somewhat different, but they're not massively different, is the Alteson-Richardson numbers, the Alteson-Richardson, the Atlas of the Transatlantic Slave Trade, published by Yale University Press, which is a book well worth owning. At $50, it's an amazing publication job, lots and lots of maps, and they have a queryable database online. The Alteson-Richardson numbers for this, which I think are generally in line with what other scholars would tell you, is that 10.7 million arrived alive out of 12.5 million embarked, leaving 1.8 million or about 15% dead at sea. 15% was kind of the norm for deaths on these voyages. I might note that there was a high mortality rate on all Atlantic crossings, especially in the 17th and 18th centuries. Sometimes on a slave ship, the mortality rates among the crew were worse even than the mortality rates among the enslaved. It was a terrible time, however you did it. In Africa, one person was killed for every one of those 12.5 million taken in slavery.
And that's where I was going, yep.
That would be 25 million enslaved or killed by the African slave trade. And if it was three dead for every one taken in slave raiding, which is an entirely speculative but not implausible number, that would mean 50 million.
And that doesn't include African human property. You can talk about the process of creolization of Black Atlantic, all that great, you know, stuff from our anthropologists and others, but that doesn't include all the folks who become Black Americans, Brazilians, Cubans, Afro-Caribbeans, etc., who were killed on this side of the Atlantic as a direct and indirect result of labor and sometimes just viciousness and killing and outright violence.
And there is not a number that I know of for all of that. Someone asked me that question a couple of days ago, and I don't know of any scholar who's attempted to compile a total number of all the people who lived under slavery over all the multiple generations. What we do know is that, as Constance was saying, the best number we have, Elston Richardson's number, 389,000 Africans were brought to the present-day United States, which is a petty figure compared with the rest of the hemisphere. 389,000 is less than 4% of the hemispheric total. Barbados, which is the size of Queens, took more. So the Africans who came here were only the seed for a domestic slave breeding industry.
And here's another question. I saw one of your great talks. It's on, I think C-SPAN picked it up, actually. And I also got an email, again, since the world is so small. Somebody emailed me about your book and said they saw you give a talk in New Orleans. I guess it was a public history gathering or a local museum. And said, Chauncey, you have
to... We were in New Orleans a couple weeks ago. We've been on a book tour for 8 weeks.
Yeah, so somebody from New Orleans emailed me and said, Chauncey, you have to get them on the podcast. And I emailed them back and said, well, I've actually talked to their publisher and we're going to make it happen. So, you know, kismet or serendipity, as they say. But during one of the talks I watched or saw online with you and your wife, again, it may have been in New Orleans, may have been elsewhere. I'm sure you'll probably remember this.
The piece we did with Jarvis DeBerry, because there's not much online. The piece we did at the Times Pick with Jarvis DeBerry.
You had a gentleman, because again, you go online and I don't use the word white supremacist or white privilege loosely. I think we can talk about, you know, racial ideologies. We can talk about systems of racial inequality and how whiteness is a historical artifact, et cetera, as you and I and your wife know. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with, you know, it's just a softball because I saw you handle it skillfully and deftly and mercilessly. When you have somebody say, because I've heard this from Black folks and white folks too, that, well, European serfs had it harder, and the proof that American slave system was relatively benign was the fact that the population grew, and we have economists have done research. I have not read this work, so you can tell me if it's true. I'm very suspicious that African slaves in the New World and the Americas, in the United States in particular, had a better diet and had higher calorie counts than Irish laborers in Boston. I'm sure you've heard all versions of this. How do you knock this stuff out? How do you rebut it?
I'm going to start with serfdom, okay?
Okay.
Number one, serfs were not alienated from the land that they worked. You could not sell them away from the estate to which they were associated. So their families and their communities were able to continue without interruption, except for, of course, war, you know, those sorts of things. But they were not allowed to be sold away. That is the foundation of the serf labor system in Europe. And as we know, here in the United States, it was an entirely different system, that the enslaved population was classified as chattel, which meant that they could be alienated from their land and they could be sold separately, which is why we could have a slave breeding industry as well as a slave labor system, because since they could be alienated from the land that they worked, it made them extremely attractive collateral for mortgages, loans, and so on. That is like one of the places where I would begin.
Yeah, so you have that beginning, and what about, you know, as I said, you know, the nonsense about calorie counts and the fact that the slaves, we had a slave breeding industry, and that somehow proves that because the number of slaves in the U.S. increased astronomically, that slavery was relatively benign. Because I've heard that one, and when I hear it, I just want to slap the person, but I smile and I'm a professional, and I try to do a little teaching if I choose to engage them.
Yes. Well, the calorie count, as we said, there was this situation in the Chesapeake that was unique in all of the hemisphere in terms of we got gender parity, which did not happen elsewhere except in Brazil, finally, very, very late, after hundreds of years of importation, shall we say. And you cannot have a slave breeding industry without that gender parity. And in the Chesapeake, because of the relatively less lethal crop that tobacco is compared to sugar, which killed anyone who worked in it on an average of 8 to 10 years, women were able to not only be born, but they could get pregnant and carry a child to term and then finally have the child live. This just does not work under the work conditions that were going on in the sugar factories of South America and the Caribbean. But as you've noticed also, in Europe, the serfs managed to have children quite a bit. So I think that the women there were receiving at least as many calories as the women in North America who were working down in the Cotton Kingdom. And I would say in a lot of cases they were probably getting a lot more because they were always able to work in their own garden plots, which was not necessarily true here.
Yeah.
And Boston, of course, that you can talk about this in terms, it's a whole different situation. I would just sort of ignore that because it doesn't work that way. The urban situation is just not the same situation as it is out in the country. And you could also mention that in an urban situation, there were far more opportunities for the enslaved to be able to purchase their own freedom and or to escape to somewhere else, which also included cities. So I think there wasn't that much of a problem in terms of the idea that they were going to starve if they got to Boston.
Yeah, I'm just jumping in. I would say also in terms of the food and the calorie count and all that, in the Chesapeake, especially once they got hogs, they did eat better than people did on sugar plantations in Cuba. The book, there's a really good book about the diets of the enslaved by Kenneth Kipple, K-I-P-L-E, and Virginia King, called Another Dimension to the Black Diaspora, Dirt Disease and Race, Site Diet Disease and Racism. Scholars have been doing great work for a long time. What we feel like what is necessary right now is to put together large arc of American history a new, the idea of this book is to provide a new narrative of American history up through emancipation that takes into account all of these things that we now know collectively, and because at some point we have to integrate it all into an overall narrative.
You know, here's a question for you and your wife, your co-writer. Historians study the past to learn about the present, how the past informs our today. And why do you think there's so much anxiety, hostility, and sometimes just overt negativity in the American public discourse about actually giving a true account of American chattel slavery? I mean, I was reading some of the reviews of Edward Baptiste's great book. I'm trying to sit down with him in the near future. And about the idea of using proper language, that slavery, it was a slave labor camp. It wasn't a plantation. It was a slave labor camp. You took people's labor. You had sophisticated accounting practices. You know, another great book that was eye-opening, I remember reading Minds of a Masterclass. And some of the, you know, the journal entries there from people's diaries writing about, my God, you know, there's one letter that jumped out at me. You probably have seen it, where it was a young man who went to Texas, I believe, or migrated west to Texas. It was in East Texas, went farther west. And he writes back to his dad, and he says, "Father, please send me two more slaves. The land is hard. I need their labor if I'm to become rich. Please, I beg you, send me more slaves." That slavery was the number one, one of the number one drivers of American empire and the economy. So why do you think there's so much reluctance to have this sort of adult conversation about slavery and empire in America?
I wouldn't attempt to psychologize. All I can do is say, this is what we think the history is. This is what, and this is the question. The thing about history informing the present, it does, but also in every generation, we ask different questions of history. We ask the questions we need to know right now. And it's really time to be talking about this. It's been amazing the last few years. We've been working on this for 5 years throughout the whole Civil War sesquicentennial, and we've just been watching one after another things in our book jump into the headline. You know, it's as a new consciousness takes hold. It's really heartening to see the new generation insisting on using different language, I must say.
And what are some of the things that you've seen? Literally, as I said, you know, 700-page book, we'll talk about the writing and the plan of the book. As I said, you do so much there and sort of your primary sources. I mean, what's jumping out?
When the Charleston Massacre happened, I mean, that was Denmark Vesey's church.
That's right.
You know, we had been writing about Denmark Vesey. We had been talking about this, writing about this community in Charleston that he belonged to and the significance of his accusation and trial and execution. To see it come back into vivid front page, this sacred site suddenly leap onto the front pages. One of the things we did working on this book was visit as many sacred sites as we could. Historic sites, but also what I would call sacred ones, like, for example, in the one that I think was most, the two that were most affecting to me, I'll mention two, is in Richmond, Virginia, which was the great wholesale slave market. In Richmond, Virginia, the site where unenacted Gabriel's Rebellion of 1800 was mm-hmm. executed. The approximate site where he was executed is marked. And there's a tree with an altar by it, and that's been placed there by the community. I don't know specifically what individuals, but it's been marked and is commemorated as a sacred site. There are many such places in New Orleans, of course, and many sacred sites in New Orleans, so a town we know pretty well. And in Natchez, Mississippi, the forks in the road. Let me pass the phone to Constance.
Mm-hmm.
The forks in the road, of course, was the final destination for very, very, very many of the people dragged across the country in a slave coffle. And it was a retail final destination, unlike New Orleans, which was wholesale. And frequently they were also brought up from New Orleans to Natchez. And there in the forks of the road, where there is presently automobile repair shops, muffler shops, automobile upholstery shops, the community had created a quiet space with green grass and a place sign that says what this place was. And in a cement circle had been placed manacles and shackles so that no one can deface that and pull it out. And many thousands died there from disease and bad treatment. It was so bad at certain places, at certain times. Some of the large slave traders would just throw people in the swamp when they died of malaria or yellow jacket and so on. And that this place has finally got some recognition as to what happened there. It's extremely affecting.
Goodness. And I asked your husband this. And here's, like I said, I'll ask you as well. So America was not a society with slaves. America was a slave society. And we're still there. It's very hard for many Americans, white, black, brown, and other, especially our white brothers and sisters, to come to terms with that. Do you think it's just, like, without psychologizing people, is it just the lie of American exceptionalism? In that when you actually talk about the nuts and bolts of the economics of slavery, the banality of evil, that it forces people to reconcile their history. I mean, I forgot who said it. You know, America is a country without history. We don't have a, I think it was Gore Vidal. America doesn't have a memory from past last Tuesday or something. Is it just that simple that people are just in denial and they don't want to confront the foundations of this country?
I would say first that the South was a slave society. Not all of the United States was a slave society. Even Baltimore was not a slave society. It was a society with slaves, which is really why we had that war.
But I would definitely agree that the antebellum South was one of the, if maybe the most pure slave society that ever existed. Everything about the antebellum South was organized around slavery to protect it, to perpetuate it, and most of all, to make sure there were no insurrections. Of course, insurrections happened constantly. There was no political class in the South except the slave-owning class. There was no democracy in the South. There was no business in the South except that, except the business that the slaveocracy basically controlled, owned, and received the benefits of. That's why migrants didn't go to the South. They went to the North, for there was no place for anyone to get a foothold for the upward mobility that migration promised if you came to the United States, because every possible form of labor was performed by slaves, which left, of course, the poor white people, the poor yeoman class who were not slave owning, without recourse to a political life, without recourse to a significant economic life, without recourse to education, without any of those things. All they had was the white supremacy that made them not slaves, and a perhaps promise that if we keep expanding and having more land open, you too can get a hold of a young, nubile, enslaved woman and start creating your own wealth. That is something that is really hard for people to understand, because except the people at the time who were living then, the abolitionists, the anti-slavery people, even many merchants who were getting wealthy out of the whole system up in the North, they understood it. But so much time has gone by, it is very difficult for us to learn this. And it's complicated stuff. As one way that Ned puts it is that with antebellum slavery, we hit a nexus of history where race meets sex meets capitalism. And all of those things are extremely complex, and when you have them all mixed together, it took us 5 years to tease out a lot of this stuff. And I didn't just begin 5 years ago. I started working on this, something like this, much earlier. That's one of the reasons why we, as a nation, are still either in denial or we're brain ignorant of what's going on, and so we have to find out what went on.
I mean, that's so brilliantly put, that nexus of capitalism, race, and sex, because, it's so spot on, because, again, you have the biopolitics, you have exploitation, you have rape culture, you have violence, you have, I was thinking, certainly can go back and forth with anecdotes, some of the most challenging conversations, again, because it's a generational story, sort of young folks born after the civil rights movement, born millennials, most certainly, they're the young folks now. And when I told college students, we've had our, conversations about slavery, and one of my favorite books is The Democratic Problem of the White Citizen, and the author recently passed away, basically talking about how you look at that intersection of race and gender and slavery in the public sphere, you have, you know, black women had no protections in, under patriarchy by their husbands against sexual violence. The black, the body of the black woman belonged to the white public to be violated at will, and that black men were not able to defend their feminine virtues, using that language, or defend them against rape culture, defend them against violence. And one of the stories I share, because I really like to use primary sources, I was like, you know, read folk in their own words. Look at these posters. Read the diaries. And when the students actually read the first-person accounts, some of them are just scared. Some of them are revolted. Anger, denial. And one of the stories I've shared, I'm sure you've read about the scholarship as well, how it was not uncommon for members of the planter class to give their children a slave as a pet, a human doll. And then that person would grow up, if they kept that person, to be an attendant, or giving slaves as wedding gifts. That this was just normal society. This was normal.
This was normal. This was normal life in that class.
Yeah.
That's, yeah, we, I mean, what we call it is the capitalized womb. That all of the pressure of the Industrial Revolution, all the entire force of the Industrial Revolution was dependent on cotton. And until Britain realized, developed its source of cotton, and India no longer needed the South as badly as it needed northern wheat and didn't support the South in the South's bid for independence. But during all this time that all of this cotton was making New York merchants fabulously wealthy, making shippers wealthy, insurers wealthy, financiers who cash flowed it all wealthy, all of the pressure to produce this cotton was brought to bear on the capitalized womb, which is to say, on women who were pressured to have children as early and as often and as late as possible. And then, as in the case of Minerva Granger, whose legal owner was Thomas Jefferson, be appraised at the age of 55 as being worth nothing.
There you go. Good old TJ and the notes on the state of Virginia. But I love, that's another powerful concept from the book, too. Obviously, when I do my reading, I have the yellow sticky tape out, putting things in the margins, but I certainly underline that and follow some of the citations about the capitalized womb. And can, you know, can either of you, you know, share some of, you know, the discoveries? Because, again, I think this is new for a lot of folks, the idea that in agricultural journals, you would have articles about slave breeding and the plantation and how best to organize the plantation, how to use violence or not. I mean, one of the articles I remember reading when I was in college was this debate about, should the owner of the plantation use physical violence, or should physical violence only be used by the overseer? And how does that affect the psychology of slave management? Because I think a lot of folks in the general public don't get, this was an economic system that had sophisticated accounting practices that used rudimentary approaches to human psychology and management of labor and sex. So, I mean, in terms of explaining that to the public, I mean, number one, do you think I'm right? And number two, what were some of your discoveries in terms of the agricultural journals and ledgers and accounting, things you saw that just either disturbed you or jumped out at you or had an aha moment?
Well, the one override, there are many, but the one in particular, and I make a point of quoting this in every interview that I do about the book, because this really sums it up more concisely and in a sense more centrally in terms of the course of the American Republic than anything. Thomas Jefferson, at the age of 77, who in a letter to his son-in-law, John Wales Epps, wrote, "I know of no era more consuming to an estate than stocking farms with men almost exclusively. I consider a woman who brings a child every 2 years as more productive than the best man of the farm. What she produces is an addition to the capital, while his labors disappear in mere consumption." What he is saying here, first of all, stocking farms with men. He is speaking of the enslaved labor force in terms otherwise applicable to livestock. This was absolutely normal. Then in saying, "I consider a woman who brings a child every 2 years more productive than the best man of the farm. What she produces is an addition to the capital, whereas his labors disappear in mere consumption." He's saying that the labor of a working hand, or working a farm worker who produces cotton or tobacco or sugar or whatever it is, produces cash flow, which can easily be dissipated in spending or go to debt, never seems to hang around very long. But that the fruit of childbearing labor was a permanent addition to the wealth, an addition to the capital, that labor was capital. Okay, now follow that line forward to 1860 or so, when 57% of the people of South Carolina are property of other people in South Carolina, and therefore 57% of the population is on the books as cash assets. Imagine how that distorts the balance sheets in the economy. It distorted the American economy incredibly. It was a huge speculative bubble, a huge Ponzi scheme. You can find references to this all the way through your journey through primary sources in American history if you know to look for that.
And when you say Ponzi scheme, I was trying to clarify terms. So when you're using that specific language, you're referring to the need to, number one, grow the system, to expand, and to make sure that all the money always flows upward.
That's right. There's always a bigger fool holding the bag. There's always someone else who needs to find a new market to sell an ever-expanding product into. I mean, it is in short capitalism. But by a Ponzi scheme, I mean that sooner or later, there would be more merchandise, and we're talking about human beings, of course, than there was buyers. It was always necessary to expand. This was why the South was always so crazy to have Texas and California, which they didn't get for slavery, and Cuba, which they did not manage to annex. Cuba could well have become a customer for a massive slave breeding operation in Mississippi, but it didn't come to pass.
And I want to clarify, you know, for you and your wife, to clarify one other term, because we've talked around it and we have the assumption and the assumed meaning. When we say slave breeding, I mean, because again, you have a wonderful, again, intro and first chapter, you define your concepts in terms, I mean, in terms of operationalizing it, because I can imagine some folk, you know, which is why I think some folks are so reluctant to have these types of conversations about the true scope of slavery in the West and in the United States in particular. When we use that phrase, what do we mean? Because I can imagine somebody saying, oh, you know, that's salacious, and that's the stuff of 1970s movies like Mandingo or Bye Bye Africa, that Italian pseudo-documentary from the early 80s, I believe, or late 70s. So when we use that language, what do we mean?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that question. It was definitely not Mandingo for a whole lot of reasons. It was not Mandingo. It was a slave breeding system. Now, in terms of how the actual mechanism, we're not really, this book is not particularly prurient. Mm-hmm. Basic concept is that women were pressured to have as many children as possible with serious negative incentives if they did not comply one way or another, namely being sold away, which was commonly considered to be the worst thing that could possibly happen. To that end, women might, of course, enslaved women were subject to sexual violation at every moment. And women were, if they did not have a mate, were might be assigned a mate, might, of course, be raped by any white man. But forced marriages, we have no numbers. Eugene Genovese, who tried, estimated that 1 in 10 slave marriages was forced. We know that slave marriage was a very real thing. That's a wild guess, really, because there's really no way to know. Michael Cadman estimates that 80% of enslaved children were born to two-parent families, though the parents might have to live on different plantations. So the way it worked was that after harvest time, traders would fan out, especially in Virginia, which continued in this business until it was forced to stop by emancipation, in Maryland, and gradually in other territories as well, traders would fan out to every farm, establish a residence at a tavern, and listen to the local gossip, find out which farmers were in trouble, and after harvest time, go visit them and see how many of their adolescent laborers they could purchase, gradually accumulating a number to bring in to Richmond, the big wholesale market, or other places, where they were then sold and shipped on down south in this big domestic slave trade. That's basically how it worked. The fact that at birth every enslaved child was worth money is central to all of this, because the fact of a slave owner being worth $75 or $100 more with the birth of a child, a value that would increase every year up until the age of 17 or 20 or so.
With every child that was born, the credit line at the bank or whoever was holding the farmer's mortgage, his credit line would increase. Credit equals money, particularly in contemporary parlance. So with each child, this credit line expanded, and it wasn't, as was earlier mentioned, this is a credit line that is a permanent asset to the account books. It wasn't something that Thomas Jefferson was going to lose by buying all that wine in France. That child is still there on the estate. So it just continued on. This meant that every year, as time went on and you had, and an owner had more slaves, particularly women who could reproduce, he had more stock, which is a word that any human being is going to find extremely, to put it mildly, distasteful to use in this context, but he had more to sell. And there were traders that would come out every year and check with, and the larger the farm, maybe the less that they themselves would sell, but it was the smaller farmers who might get into trouble financially. They could no longer, like, carry whatever their mortgage was. But that year, because Prissy's Susie turned 15 and had proven herself pregnant, he could sell her and pay off whatever it was that he needed to pay off. That's one of the ways that it worked. It worked in so many different ways, but mostly when people say slave breeding, they think it's like somebody is standing there and, you know, overseeing a breeding line, something like that. But mostly it would be on the order of you with this person, you with this person. It would be dividing up new purchases with your older purchases. Men for women, women for men, if you didn't have gender parity on your place.
The one obvious and notorious example of that is James Polk, we have to get to Polk, the three great enablers of the slave breeding industry, Jefferson, Jackson, and Polk.
Mm-hmm.
Polk, who, while president, bought slaves in secret from the White House, bought slaves for his Mississippi plantation, while taking actions that would increase their value by making war to annex Texas. There's a letter from his brother-in-law, I believe, who was writing back to him from the plantation while he was in the White House, saying, when I go back next time, I will bring down more women for your men. I'm paraphrasing, I don't have the exact quote in front of me. As you have too many men for the women you have. So he's describing forced mating. Very matter-of-fact letter to the President of the United States saying, I got to get some more women to force mate with the men that you own.
We made the allusion earlier to Mandingo as a way of sort of thinking about these distorted understandings of chattel slavery in America and the popular imagination. How do you think, you know, what are some, you know, good is not a good word, I'll rephrase it, accurate, are there any accurate depictions of slavery in popular culture? I mean, 12 Years a Slave, for example, Django, which is a fantastical fairy tale, but in some ways is more accurate than a movie like Roots. I mean, what are some of the movies or films that you've seen that either made you just repulse and shake your head as a historian, or made you say, okay, they sort of got that right?
I think I'm going to start with what is actually my husband's specialty, which is music. Something he often likes to say, movies told me lies, music tells me the truth. And I would like you to look at the third verse of My Old Kentucky Home, the verse that nobody ever sings anymore, even in their great compilations of the Stephen Foster American Songbook, which is about, it traces literally what is happening to a man being sold from Kentucky to a sugar plantation in Louisiana and knows that he's going to die. It's the same trajectory that Harriet Beecher Stowe uses in Uncle Tom's Cabin.
It goes, the head must bow and the back will have to bend, wherever the darkie must go. A few more days and the trouble all will end in the fields where the sugar canes grow. A few more days for to tote the weary load. No matter, 'twill never be light. A few more days till we totter on the road. Then my old Kentucky home. Good night. This is a song about a man being worked to death in a sugar prison camp in Louisiana. That's the third verse of My Old Kentucky Home. It's the state song of Kentucky, although they don't sing that verse. In movies, the closest I've seen to accuracy in a movie, 12 Years a Slave. There were a couple of invented scenes in there, a couple of invented things, but really, for in terms of historical accuracy for a movie, it's far above anything else I've seen, and of course it was not made by Americans.
And Sankofa is another great gem of a film, too, if folks haven't seen it.
Oh, yeah, but that's not, like, set here.
Oh, yeah, the Caribbean.
The Caribbean has done quite a few really fine movies about this matter, I believe, and I haven't seen anywhere near as many of them as I would like. But here, this is my hobby horse, shall we say? But here in the United States, with our film and television industry, we always deal in mythology. And this is one of the things this is one of the answers to the question you asked earlier about why we are not knowing the truth about all of these matters these days, after so many years have gone by, after so much research has been done, when it was so well documented in the time that these things were taking place. And the movies have a great, great deal to do with it. Popular culture has a great deal to do with it. I spent one summer watching Westerns from Netflix, and I went through the Netflix Western database and checking off each one in which the protagonist is an ex-Confederate whose life had been destroyed by the Union.
Yep.
And you know how many I found in which the Union, an ex-Union soldier was a protagonist? Hardly any. Hardly any at all. Even when it was, Fort Apache was an exception, and of course, our protagonist marries an Indian woman who, of course, must die. You know how that works. This is our way, this had been our way of reunifying the country, which was to write slavery out of the historical narrative. And the movies were so important for that.
I mean, and, you know, the whole idea of race and reunion, you know, you lie about slavery, you make the struggle noble so that North and South can have reconciliation, and you have monstrous, and I call the movie monstrous films like Gone with the Wind that people still celebrate. I saw a thing at the Atlantic. They had a story about every year they have these parties where you have all these people dressing up as quote-unquote Southern Belles and Confederate gentlemen at these Gone with the Wind parties, and there are black and brown folks there. I was like, how can a person of color with any self-respect participate in the mythology? But the mythology is that powerful.
And it's partly because we have those dresses, and we have those horses, and we have swords. That's what we like about the Civil War. The dresses, the swords, and the horses. It makes it look adventurous, exciting, thrilling, and glamorous.
We tend not to use the term Civil War because, and I've never seen, how can you make an honest movie about slavery in the United States? I mean, you know, right? It was a Revolutionary War. The Revolutionary War began January 1st, 1863, with the Emancipation Proclamation, which I think is the most radical document in American history, because it was the document that decommissioned a kind of property that had always existed, a kind of property that was so valuable that the wealthiest members of the society would rather tear the country apart, destroy the United States, then lose it. And more to the point, authorized the arming of black soldiers, the enlistment and arming of black soldiers. And once 200,000 or so black soldiers entered the war, it could be won. And they were explicitly fighting a war to end slavery. The kind of the counter-narrative to all this we've been talking about, all this victimization, is the ongoing resistance and war by the enslaved and free black population against this condition. A long tradition of black resistance that goes back everywhere in the hemisphere where there was slavery in every era. But in the United States is everywhere. It's in all of the wars that the country fought. In the War of Independence, when the enslaved overwhelmingly sided with the British,
with
not
the British.
With the slave owners. In the War of 1812, when again many took this advantage to defect behind British lines and escape the slave owners. In the War of Conquest that Andrew Jackson fought in Florida against Maroons and Native American. Of course, the so-called Civil War, which was among the other things, it was a great slave rebellion.
And that narrative of resistance, and I'm so glad you brought that up, because I would never want folks, and certainly they folks who listen to podcasts and read my writings online, know that's the theme I repeatedly return to, is the black freedom struggle and the resistance of black and brown folks with, you know, some white allies to the institution. One of our great American heroes, John Brown, certainly, and all these other quiet revolutionaries who fought against American apartheid, is that, again, going back to, you know, I hate to say the masses are asses. I think it's cultivated by our popular culture, a broken school system, and a culture of denial. Again, going back to American exceptionalism, that the South was a military state, paranoid beyond belief about uprisings and resistance by African Americans. And that, you know, as I said, when I tell students of color especially that you have agency, your folks fought back, your ancestors resisted, I'm excited by so many of them saying, my God, I had no idea. And then also troubled by the idea that you just thought that folks were in a state of learned helplessness and didn't fight back like every other occupied and aggrieved population?
That's right.
Because you talked about the Civil War as the first or the second American Revolution, depending on what historian you talk to, because I'm just so happy that that narrative is taking over in terms of the historiography and how we...
If you're looking at it from the point of view of the enslaved, the American Revolution was no revolution. If you're looking at it from the point of the enslaved, they did not side with the so-called American Revolution, and we argue in from Virginia down south, a major incentive to go for independence was to protect slavery against the growing power of British abolitionism.
That's
independence
right.
from Britain did nothing to change the status of the enslaved, which is why we start our book in the earliest colonial times instead of in 1776, because American history doesn't begin in 1876, and particularly the history of American slavery.
To sort of winding down as a concluding question before you share your upcoming appearances and where to buy the book and all that wonderful information, how did you sit down as a practical matter, because I love to ask people about craft and nuts and bolts, to sit down and say, here's the outline, here's what we're going to include, and here's what we're going to exclude, because you've written just a wonderful tome, and I mean that in the best sense. I mean, so much going on here. But what were some of the hard decisions you had to make editorially about what to leave in, what to take out, what the narrative should look like?
We talked about earlier that our publisher is wonderful. I'm going to tell you a story. We were going to take out almost all of the first section, the colonial section, because 70,000 words, because the book was getting so long. And our editor looked at the proposal of this, and he said, put it back. I like it better the other way. How about that? So
that's very rare.
That's very rare. And one of the reasons, though, there are several reasons why there is so much work we put so much emphasis on the colonial era. Partly it was happenstance. When we began this book at Washington College from this fellowship for writing the project, part of the prize was they put us in an 18th century house. And very soon after we moved in, also a library of Leo LeMay, a great American studies scholar whose specialty was Benjamin Franklin, he'd left his library to the Star Center, which was sponsoring us, this fellowship, and they put all the books in the house. And he had all of this amazing collection, including Indian treaties, both up in New England and in the South. He had the bound papers and letters and journals of the presidents. I mean, all this stuff was just right here. So if you're like up at 3 o'clock in the morning, you could grab a volume of George Washington's letters and just start paging through. It was quite wonderful. But beyond that, it was clear we were doing a narrative history, which meant this being the kind of history it was, it had to be chronological. So you begin at the beginning, and we knew it was going to stop with the Emancipation Proclamation and the first years right after that, because this was about the slave breeding industry. And that was definitely the thing that stopped with the Emancipation Proclamation and that war. No matter what happened afterwards, whatever anyone wants to say, that stopped. The capitalized wound stopped. And now I'm going to let Ned talk.
I think she said it very well.
I think so, too.
You know, we've been together 40 years, and our consciousness has grown together over the years. Very often we'll both read the same book, very different things about it, out of it, and talk about it. And that was more the process than anything else, was us talking through all the sources that we were reading and building up the narrative. I did the drafting, and it's in my voice, which was part of the deal, because it's a continuation of the voice of my previous books. Constance was also part of the previous books as an advisor, but this time around she's a co-author. And although I'm drafting it and structuring the argument in book form, the content had all been discussed at home before it came out of my fingers into the keyboard. It was very much a product of both of our heads. It was a marvelous process.
I was going to, you know, make an observation. As I said, thinking about writing and the process, I always like to ask folks who sat down and had crafted, you know, wonderful books, did the book write itself at a certain point? And the story was there, and you just had to synthesize it? Or did you have to fight with every page?
Writing is rewriting, and you have to, especially the front of the book has to move as fast as possible. I am a big believer that you must rewrite and rewrite and rewrite to make the writing as clean as possible, as a gesture of respect to your reader. Your reader deserves to read the easiest reading book possible. That's my big thing, is comprehensibility and readability. And that doesn't take care of itself. But what did happen was that as you move forward in the chronology, in that run-up to 1860, as the country comes unglued completely in the 1850s, the events take on a momentum. And although the book is long, I feel that there is a momentum that builds all the way through the entire arc, that car crash in slow motion that was coming.
I mean, as I said, you know, it's a long book, but wonderfully readable. And I would add it, you know, folks ask for suggestions. I mean, there's the great short book, Questioning Slavery. Eric Foner's great work, Stephen Hahn, Thomas Holt. We can go down the list. Classics, Eric Williams, Winthrop Jordan, Curtin's work. And certainly you and your wife's book deserves a place among those. I mean, what you've accomplished here is amazing.
Thank you. That's very nice of you.
Oh, absolutely. It's right there on the shelf. When I say that, I mean, this is next to Winthrop Jordan, Eric Williams, Tom Holt, Foner, all those folks.
Oh, those are the big dogs.
Yeah, this is essential reading. Essential reading. And the other thing I like as we wind down is that it's long. And as I said, for somebody who's really interested in these topics, there's so much there. But for someone who's new to them, for example, my mother, I'm going to give her a copy of the book to read. And I know that she'll get something out of it, because there's just so many hidden gems with the narrative and just so many moments where you just stop and say, wow, you knew this truth. But to see it presented so forcefully is really a compliment to both of you. But where can folks find you online? Where are you going to be speaking in the future? Where can they buy your book?
We just concluded our arc of appearances. We actually don't have a calendar of events coming up right now, but our Chicago Review Press is the publisher, and their website has a 50% off deal on the book, actually.
Wow.
You can, of course, get it anywhere books are sold, and if your local library doesn't have it, ask the library to get it. If your local independent bookstore doesn't have it, ask your independent bookstore to get it, or you can get it from your favorite online retailer. But Chicago Review Press has go to www.chicagoreviewpress.com and use the code, this is one word, capitals, Holiday 2015. H-O-L-I-D-A-Y 2015. And they can go there and buy one copy or as many as they want.
Also and the e-book version.
And there's also, they also have the e-book version, so you can actually get the Kindle direct from them if you want. It's the proto Kindle movie pocket. Uh-huh. Moby pocket. It's the it's the Moby pocket.
But I want to thank both of you. As I said, it's all technology and fancy. We edit things out, but we had to figure some things out in the beginning. And sometimes when that happens, you're just like, man, this is going to be one of those sorted conversations. But then we get it all figured out, and it was as exciting and rich and wonderful. And I mean, in terms of your teaching about a very challenging subject, that better than I could have imagined. And it's one of my favorite conversations as of late. And I've talked to some really cool people. But everybody should run out and get
this. Wow, thank you.
Thank you. We follow your blog, you know. We've been watching you, so we've been watching you. So I feel you know, it's an honor for us to be on your podcast.
Well, thank you, and we're getting some good stuff in the future. We'll have to sit down and chat again because the world is so small.
Yeah. There's a lot to talk about.
But again, I want to thank both of you, Ned and Constance, for sitting down and chatting on the podcast. I really appreciated it.
Thank you.
Powerful, huh? That was an amazing bit of teaching and sharing from Ned and Constance Sublette. As I said, I opened up because about that story about going down to Harlem as a kid, because that was amazing. Those places where you found hidden knowledge, and a lot of those bookstores are still there. A lot of our bookstores are closed, but you never know when those gems, and I've written about it before, that Black Book. Get the book called The Black Book. Came out in the '70s or '80s. I think Toni Morrison edited it. That book was so influential in terms of my growth and my own thinking about my identity as a Black American. But When he sang that song, I told you, that hit me. And then her story about them throwing those Black bodies in them swamps in Texas. As the book title goes, the other half has not been told, people. And that's why I asked him. I said, why do you think Americans are so willingly ignorant, willfully ignorant, Black and white and brown of this history? Maybe the lie of American exceptionalism. Maybe, and I've thought about this. I don't know if I picked this up from Naeem Akbar, who I'm determined to get on the podcast, by the way. Or maybe going to a Black man. Maybe, you know, the great mentors I had who taught me AFAM history, Afro-Caribbean history, Black Atlantic, that maybe folk are in denial. And I don't think it's a particularly American phenomenon, but maybe it has something to do with American exceptionalism, American hopefulness. The idea of the shining city on the hill, a country with this democratic rhetoric birthed of the twin evils of the genocide of First Nations people and the mass murder and enslavement of Black people. Maybe every country has lies. And maybe if you take a full accounting of those lies, then you have to do a personal inventory. And then you start to see that all the things that you got, the shoulders of the ancestors you stand on, or maybe the anchors that hold you down, that life isn't fair. Maybe that's it. But this is stuff that every American should, we should have learned the true history of slavery in this country in elementary school. But we didn't. But I want to thank Ned and Constance one more time. All right, another swig of the soda. Whew. All right, hold on. So now switching gears, because as I said, that was heavy and it was awesome. And I'm so glad they got that coupon. Go to their website for the book, go to the press and get that 50% or 25% off coupon. Please read this book, people. I don't shill for things. I don't have authors on here that I don't think are bringing it. Then I rarely really say, please buy something. Support their scholarship, support their work so we can have other amazing work out of that press. Let's get behind this book, and please email the press, email the publisher, and say, I've got the book, I heard it on Chauncey Devega's podcast, I've heard about the Sublettes, or I went on YouTube and I watched some of their talks. This is an amazing project, but let's put our money where our mouths are, people. I bought the book, I'm going to get another copy from my mom's, and I'm going to be giving this gift to people. This is going to be my gift for some people this Christmas. Hanukkah, festivals, whatever you want to celebrate. So pop culture stuff, because you know next week, the Cadillac car is pulled up. Champion Joe Lansdale and I are going for a ride. Talking about Happen Leonard. Talking about martial arts. Talking about life. Talking about manhood. Talking about race. Talking about freedom. Talking about the creative process. Champion Joe said, brother from another mother. Sometimes you just meet somebody and through their work, you realize you just click and vibe. And me and Champion Joe do it. 90-minute Broadway, as they say in pro wrestling, on the next episode of the podcast. That's next week. Star Wars week, people. I can't believe it's here. Bill the Lizard and I are going to be doing a special Star Wars show where we sit down before we watch the movie, after we watch the movie. And I'm going to give you a heads up because I was complaining about it on Twitter. Let me calm down. Because I have a fear now, because what happened to me at Mad Max, that I may need to stay in the apartment, my cluttered, overpriced, tiny Chicago apartment with bad heat for a week so I don't get sick or hurt and not see Star Wars Force Awakens. I went to see, and I'm giving, this is the Chauncey Devega public service announcement, people. If you have pre-ordered your Star Wars The Force Awakens tickets, if you have done this, and you go to an AMC theater and use your credit card or debit card to buy the tickets, especially I think if it's the one you use for the ticket, a prompt will come up on the screen that says you have tickets on will call. I saw this and immediately realized the mess, the hugga-muggery, the chaos that was about to ensue, the destruction of my hopes and dreams, and bad juju. That's magic, people. Not an anti-Semite. I got love for my Jewish brothers and sisters. I got Jewish relatives, by the way. Juju, obia, that the tickets was going to be coming out. So I stopped the machine and I went to the cashier guy, nice young gentleman. I said, sir, I got pre-sale Star Wars tickets. I do not want the tickets to print out because I'll lose them. And then I'd be in crisis. Waiting 30 years for this. The gentleman says, oh, well, I'll take care of it. And he's getting into the computer and he's like, uh-oh. I say, what's that uh-oh? The tickets printed out, people. I got two tickets in my hands with my small hands, look like a child's hands, people say, with small fingers. It says Star Wars, two of them. Episode 7, Thursday, 7 p.m., December 17th. I put it in an envelope. I wrote Star Wars tickets. I put them away. And I was mad. I said, how can I get this revoked? He's like, I don't know. The ones they print, you can't put them back. I said, what happens if I lose them, sir? He said, and he got a little nervous. I'm sure not the only person pissed. He says, go up to customer service, guest services. They'll help you. So I go up to guest services, and the young gentleman, he saw the rage. He saw the rage, the dark side in me. And he came over, and I was like, sir, I have a concern. It printed out my tickets. He's like, I know. Everybody's been complaining all day. I didn't know. I was like, well, what happens if we lose these tickets? He's like, sir, you just come upstairs with whatever credit card you use. We'll look it up in the system, and we'll print you out tickets. Don't even go in the line. Just get right in the elevator, which is a trick I'm going to use to cut ahead of the line, by the way, when I see Star Wars Thursday. He said, just get in the elevator, and if they try to stop you, tell them you're going to guest services. And I said, man, what are you going to do? What you going to do about it, man? Not that, you know, thousands of geeks, maybe individually they wouldn't be able to do anything, but maybe thousands of us mad about Star Wars. And dude was really, really nervous. He said, sir, and I said, what if I bring the paper I printed out from Fandango? He's like, yeah, bring that. And I was like, will it pre-print the tickets again? No. But I promise you, we've been told to promise everyone that they'll get into Star Wars opening night if they bought their tickets and lose them. I said, I'm going to hold you to it, brother, because if you don't, it's going to be merciless. I'm going to unleash the dark side on his behind. I'm so excited. I feel like a kid, but we're going to have a special Star Wars episode in addition to Champion Joe. So we got Champion Joe on that Thursday. We'll do Star Wars movie Friday or Monday because I'm seeing it opening night and Friday. He's seeing it Saturday. This movie is either going to be awesome or horrible. I've increasingly come to believe there is no middle ground. We talked about it before. Abrams has said to Howard Stern it is basically a soft reboot. We have figured out the plot. Go to my Facebook page, which I'm getting a lot of activity on. As I said, I talked about this last week. I had to figure this out. Facebook getting thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of interactions a week. Although people are not liking Brother Chauncey Devega on Facebook, so please go do that because it's all appearances. Still getting the comments on ChaunceyDevega.com, but I feel like I'm splitting audience. I got to figure that out. But you know, I've been writing some posts about the plot. I think we have basically figured it out. If you don't know what I'm talking about, go to ChaunceyDevega.com. Look under Ghetto Nerds or Facebook. You'll see it. Track down the last episode with Bill the Lizard on the podcast. He and I chop it up. I think we've got the plot down. The question then becomes, what is J.J. Abrams' surprise? Again, I bet money that Darth Plagueis the Wise is in this movie, or he's alluded to. The Supreme Commander Snoke, or Snoke, whatever that name is. That's Darth Plagueis. I hope he doesn't do some swerve with Luke Skywalker being evil. That just doesn't work, people. He's a Jedi. He's in isolation. He's meditating. The Force, I believe, has come back into the universe, just like Arthurian legend. It went out of the universe with the death of the Emperor. Now it's back. Chewie or Han Solo get killed at the end of the movie. I think that's pretty clear. And when Luke shows up on people, I'm getting there at noon. I'm not eating that day. I'll have a piece of bread. I'm not drinking anything. I'm going to get some candy. I'm going to take Pepto-Bismol or Lamotil, four of them, so I don't have to have accident, stomach get nervous, or during the movie, I'll be so excited. I don't want to have problems or have to use the toilet. And I'll go out for a feast, a post-Star Wars feast at Capitol Grill and get a steak. That's where I'm going. $50 steak, filet mignon, bacon-wrapped, horseradish crusted, and I'm going alone on Friday. Yeah, Friday is going to be even better than the first day. It'll either be wonderful or horrible. But folks, do you feel the force? I do. I'm so excited. So J.J. Abrams, please don't mess this up. But again, them tickets print out, put them away. Patriots are still in a funk. I don't know what the hell's going on with that team. That game I saw with Belichick and that kick and the mess, they've lost their confidence. They've lost their rhythm. Patriots, get it together. We're winners, not losers in Patriots Nation. WWE, Raw, and SmackDown still stinks. I have basically watched every pay-per-view. I want to thank a good friend of mine, gifted me the WWE Network. I have him back on the show, Mr. Brian. He and I got to catch up and see how he feels about WWE as of late, because it really does stink. I watch almost every pay-per-view. I may not watch this Tables, Ladders, and Chairs this week, folks. There's no, the narrative is off. They're forcing Roman Reigns, forcing us to like him when they should turn him heel, and it's just not interesting. The best thing on that show, and if you are not into wrestling, just go on YouTube and type in New Day WWE. These three brothers are doing a thing with bronies and unicorns and Final Fantasy music and video games, and there's so many levels of sort of meta geek goodness to what they're doing and their promos and performing that you cannot help but like them. They're playing with notions of masculinity and sexuality in some very subversive ways that are just out in plain sight. So big, much love to the New Day. I hated them when they came out, but that was part of it. And then they turned heel and it just worked out wonderfully. What else very quickly? You had Star Wars. We did the fundraiser. Joe Lansdale is next week. Great documentary, folks, as we wind down, because I gave you a lot of stories, my personal life. Lustful Eyes and African Priests. Elephantiasis of the Dingus and Penis, which is just me getting fat in my upper thighs. Soda and Starburst Addiction. And a wonderful conversation about serious matters. Got to laugh to keep from crying sometimes after that heavy conversation. Wonderful, rich teaching. American Slave Coast. So I saw a documentary. I'm going to make another recommendation. 180 degrees opposite of this wonderful book that we had on the episode. On Netflix, I've already told Werner Herzog's Bear. I've told Bill the Lizard to watch this. There is a documentary. If you have not seen it, if you are a child of the 80s or early 90s or 70s or just a film geek, it's called, I think, Electric Boogaloo, The Story of Canon Films. People, Canon Films, they made Delta Force. They made Electric Boogaloo. Remember that? They made all those horrible Death Wish sequels. They made movies with gorillas and orangutans that were just little people in orangutan suits. They made Skin Flicks. They made Lady Chatterley's Lover. They made some other movie about the same time period. Softcore porn. This movie, horrible movie called Sahara. This movie, those movies are my childhood. I'm sitting there. I watched that thing twice. I ordered it on Amazon because I couldn't get it locally. Buy that documentary on the making and the history of Canon Films, Electric Boogaloo. It is on Netflix. If you're going to watch this, people, put the kids away because there's a lot of nudity. The best sort of nudity from the 80s and late 70s. And it's a history of the Israeli film industry. Delta Force. What else did they do? All them Chuck Norris movies. American Ninja. Bloodsport. That horrible He-Man in the Masters of the Universe. Lord of Jesus. They did all that stuff. And there's so much history about cinema there. And I realized watching that documentary, Marina Sirtis is naked in it several times. And I'm looking at all these beautiful women. My God. And I guess it's a formative experience. I'm like, whoa, coming of age, watching those films. Now I see where a lot of my taste in women comes from in terms of I like all women, all shapes and sizes and colors. But let's be real, folk. I have a thing. I like racially ambiguous women who are natural in their body type, who can have small breasts or big ones. But as you see in the documentary, a lot of natural stuff going on in the hair, all over the body. And I'm looking at naked Marina Sirtis. I'm looking at all these other naked women and Lady Chatterley's Lover. I'm like, I grew up watching this stuff during my youthful years and having dreams. I was like, that's where my aesthetic sensibilities come from in terms of women. I solved a puzzle. But I don't want to give away the whole documentary. You will be laughing. Get a beer, whiskey, or whatever your mind-altering substance of choice is. And watch that documentary. I cannot give it a higher rating. And here's another gem. I did not know. I knew something was wrong at the time. Death Wish 2. I remember watching that saying, this is like really messed up in the way they're treating women and raping them. And it seemed like they really liked treating women badly. And I didn't have the vocabulary for it at like 10 or 11. probably 9. But after watching this documentary as an adult, I'm like, that was messed up. And Death Wish 2 is heavily edited in the UK and banned, I believe, in some countries. And I did not know that. So check out that Electric Boogaloo, the history, I believe, is called The History of Canon Films. And you will not be disappointed. So as we wind down, is our habit here on the eponymous name podcast, known as the Chauncey Devega Show. Champion Joe Lansdale, part 2. Check him out. We talked earlier. You can find that interview on YouTube. We'll put that up here on Libsyn. We shouldn't have any problems like we had with a troll before causing trouble. But if not, it'll go up on YouTube, too. You can always find it. Great conversation about life, martial arts, Bruce Lee, comic books, Batman. Ooh, Edward Rice Burroughs, John Carter of Mars, sci-fi, race. Man, we just talked 90 minutes of gold. So that's next week. Again, the fundraiser, doubling down. If you can, if you're willing, if you're able, 5, 10, 20, 25. We had some amazingly generous people, folks. As I said, a few more folks show that amazing level of generosity because I had my hand open and said, hey, we're a little behind where we should be able to wrap this up by next week, I hope, next Friday, Star Wars Day. Let's make that a goal, folks, who hear the podcast. Next Thursday is Star Wars Day. Let's double down if you have been procrastinating, if you've been on the fence, and if you can, if you cannot, if the resources are tight, if you got other concerns, get the kids the holiday gifts, too. You got a little change left over? Help a brother out. It'll be appreciated. Show some of that love. But you know, you go to chauncevega.com, you hit that PayPal link. And again, I keep saying, and a few folks are doing it, if you can go to iTunes and click the star rating, write a comment or review, that will help get visibility on the podcast because it's really important for that iTunes algorithm to push us up so we can go back to being, there's a little point there, we were like top 50. For a moment, they're like top 25, believe it or not. So let's get back on that because again, I think we are at a precipice, fork in the road. And this podcast episode with the Sublettes was awesome. And as I said, please share it with folks. I think it's a great entry point for folks who want to catch up on the podcast. As I said, we damn near going to be about 100 by the time I'm done recording folks this week and next week. So we're on episode 70-something now. I will be reorganizing actually the numbering. And let me get it switched because you hear my voice breaking up a little bit. That's the See, when you get into the Shasta, she gives as much as she takes. You got to keep rehydrating. Hold on. One last sip to shut down, to close down this episode of the podcast. Hold on. Oh. Good. Baby. So, please, if you can, tweet, download, share, and otherwise circulate the eponymously named podcast. And it's a Chauncey Devega Show with your friends, with your family, and with other folks you think could be curious. And as is our standard closer, please reach out to someone you have not spoken to as of late. Try to mend a broken bridge or friendship or relationship where there's been a falling out. If you haven't heard from somebody, inquire and see how they are. Just reach out to them. If it's a big deal, send a letter because people have to open a letter. And you will know that you took the high road. You will know that you did the right thing. And you may be surprised when that person responds positively. And if they don't respond or they're negative or they're hostile, and some people nurture pain, they hold on to grievances, and some of them is just pride. They know they were wrong, but they can't admit it. Or they think they messed up so bad, they don't have the humility, and a lot of people don't have this level of humility, to say I'm wrong or I'm sorry. A lot of people, the hardest thing for them to say is I'm wrong or I'm sorry. They'll do everything to show you. I saw a woman on divorce court, you know I like my daytime shows, who basically admitted to the judge, who looks like my aunt, by the way, my aunt Maybelline, that she can't say I'm sorry. She said, I can't say I'm wrong to my husband or I'm sorry, because she grew up and she was just hardened so badly by her mother and the women around her. Had to be tough, had to be strong black woman. She couldn't realize there was strength in saying I'm sorry. So if you encounter a person like that, do a personal assessment and understand where they're coming from. And maybe as they grow in their own self, and they get to know where your heart is coming from, maybe they can say, I'm sorry. And you'll have helped both of you. But reach out to someone you've had a falling out with, an argument with, someone that you want to reconnect with. You may likely be pleasantly surprised. So please take care of our animal friends, winged, reptilian, fish, insect, my spider friend is still up there, doggy people, cat people, bird people, squirrel people, all of our various our plant friends. I don't want to leave out our plant friends. A lot of folks have indoor plants. Take care of the plant people, too. Make the world a better place. And you see a homeless brother and sister, make eye contact. Acknowledge their humanity. And if you can, give a person on these mean streets a dollar. Buy them a sandwich. Take care of some. Hey, we got them Subway deals right now, 50% double meat, 50 cent. Buy somebody a sandwich. let's try to make our little corner of the world a little bit better. A little bit better every day if we can. So until next week, Joe Lansdale, Champion Joe, here on The Chauncey Devega Show. Please be well, be safe, and I want to thank all of you who have reached into your pockets, pocketbooks, cookie jars of change, and elsewhere, and send a brother some love during this fundraising season. I greatly, greatly, greatly appreciate it.